For the week of April 11th through the 17th, Hawaii had the lowest infection rate and mortality rate in the nation since the very beginning of this pandemic, going back to March 7th of last year. Hawaii has had the best outcomes in the nation from the health perspective. And that's really important, and it is because of all the sacrifices that each and every one of us have made on behalf of our community to keep our community healthy and safe. I'm excited today to be able to announce, because of your collective actions, that we are going to reduce traveling restrictions for those who have been vaccinated. Beginning May 11th, fully vaccinated travelers who received their vaccine in Hawaii may travel inter-county without having to quarantine for 10 days. Prior to May 11th, I'll be signing an emergency proclamation that will implement this action for inter-county exceptions. I really want to thank Lieutenant Governor Green and General Hara and all the county mayors, Mayor Kawakami, Victorino, and Roth, and Mayor Blangiardi here on Oahu for all of their work in making this happen. Together, we made a decision to start with the inter-county travel program for those vaccinated in the state of Hawaii, because we can verify the information and their vaccination status. In addition to this phased approach, it will allow us to validate the screening process necessary, and I think most importantly, learn about what kinds of bottlenecks and delays it may inject into our screening process for inter-island travel. And I think most importantly, we are monitoring and continue to monitor the rate of virus activity in our community, hospitalizations and fatalities here caused by COVID-19. Our number one priority remains protecting the health and well-being of Hawaii's citizens. And we continue to work to improve the systems and programs in order to keep our community safe and re-energize our economy. I really want to thank Lieutenant Governor Green and General Hara, Dr. Char, and the entire team for all of their work in the Safe Travels Program and in dealing with this vaccination exception. Each of them will be speaking this afternoon, as well as the county mayors. Mahalo.
Thank you very much, Governor. Our next speaker is Lieutenant Governor Josh Green.
Aloha, friends. We've come a long way together, as Gov pointed out. Thank you, Gov. Thank you, General. Come a long way together through this pandemic, and it's my responsibility today to speak a little bit about where we've been and where we're going. I would say the big picture is we can only make today's move at the governor's behest because we've been careful, because the Safe Travels program has worked, and because we've been very diligent throughout this crisis to keep cases down, to keep mortality down, and to begin to open up in a scientific and smart way. So let's review a little bit about where we've been. If you look at the past, over January 5th, that was right after Christmas, New Year's, we had a 7-day average of 140 new daily cases. We had a 3.48 positivity rate, and 105 of our citizens were sick with COVID in the hospital. This was right after the surge from the holidays. Too dangerous to be traveling, too dangerous to not wear masks. We had just begun to vaccinate our community. So that was where we sat right at the beginning of the year. And here we are today on April 20th. Our 7-day average is greatly reduced to 80 new cases on average. Our positivity rate is less than half of what it was, 1.61%, and we have only 43 individuals. Though even one individual is too much, but we only have 43 individuals in the hospital. And that makes a big difference because this empowers the counties to provide the care that's needed and for us to provide any service, whether it's our people or travelers, services if they get sick. This empowers the governor to make this rule change. So we started Safe Travels about 6 months ago, Gov. And over those 6 months, we've seen 2,647,865 total travelers via the Safe Travels Hawaii program come to Hawaii. About 2 million of these were guests, visitors, and about 600,000 of us returning home or having our relatives come here to see us. So it's a lot of people, and we've been able to keep our counts down. And as Governor pointed out very eloquently, we have the lowest case rate and fatality rates in the United States by a big margin. And it's because we've always done what we can to be safe. But there are things we can do better, as we know, because we want to bring our loved ones back together. There are people who need to get to the neighbor islands. I'm a neighbor islander, kind of in my heart. I was there on the Big Island this weekend in the ER. So what we had to do was find a way, the governor, at his behest, to make sure that we could do it safely. Well, one thing that has changed significantly is the vaccination program. As of today, and we give thanks to Director Char, to Libby, who's done a great job, and General Hara's team, and all of the mayors in each of the counties, we have now delivered 1,076,512 doses of the vaccine in our state. And what does that mean to us as a bigger number? 35% of us in our state have received at least one dose. So now the case counts will come down. Hopefully everyone will still wear masks. But the energy is to be able to be safer and to get back out there, whether it's opening our businesses or traveling. And people really want to travel, and we know that. So the governor tasked us with a plan, put together something that would be safe so we could travel at first safely inner island. So that's what you'll hear the details from General Hara. But just in brief, if people are fully vaccinated, as the governor has said, and there's a definition to that, we're going to say it a couple times so people know what that means. If you had both of the Pfizer or Moderna shots, or you've had the Johnson & Johnson shot, and 14 days have passed to build up your immunity to get your antibodies, then you are fully vaccinated. At that point, you'll have the process to be able to travel inter-island, inter-county, by uploading your card, and General will go through the rest of the details. It is a travel exception. It is a part of the Safe Travels program. It's not meant to stop anyone from having their civil rights. It's just another way for us to be safe. We still have the pretest in place. We still have the Safe Travels program in place. But now, because we are vaccinated, we'll be able to move about much more freely and safely. So that's what I wanted to share, but I think we've done extraordinarily well, not without sacrifice, not without pain and suffering, but we're now seeing really the end of this pandemic, the beginning of the end, and that's why good things are happening today. Aloha.
Thank you very much. Moving on to Mayor General Kenneth Hara, Major General Kenneth Hara, Director Haima.
Thank you, Governor Ige, Lieutenant Governor Green. Good afternoon and aloha. As mentioned, beginning May 11, the counties of Hawaii, Maui, and Kauai will grant exceptions to fully vaccinated inter-county travelers who are vaccinated here in Hawaii. Please go to chart one. The definition of fully vaccinated that the Lieutenant Governor just mentioned is 2 weeks after receiving the last recommended vaccine dose. The exception will be granted on the 15th day following their last recommended dose. Accepted travelers will not be subject to the 10-day travel quarantine or any post-travel pretest requirements. Go to chart two, please. Those requesting an exception must create an account in the Safe Travels Hawaii digital platform, complete the online forms, affirm that they are fully vaccinated and that the card is not fraudulent, and then upload their PDF or photocopy of the vaccination card. Travelers must also have in their possession the CDC vaccination record card while traveling. Our schedule to go live in the Hawaii Safe Travels digital platform is Friday, the morning of May 7th. And these are for flights starting on May 11th. Initially, the system will not validate the cards. That will be done by screeners. It is important to note that if someone travels prior to they are fully vaccinated, they will not receive the vaccination exception, even if they're 15 days within their travel period. The exception is only for travelers who receive their vaccination in Hawaii, and this includes military, those vaccinated through the VA or the federal pharmacy program. At this moment, the state is unable to verify vaccinations for individuals vaccinated outside of the state. Individuals' health information will not be shared. The only information used to validate your vaccination is your name, date of birth, date of vaccination, the vaccination type, lot numbers, and the location you're vaccinated. This is the same information that is on your CDC card. Those that elect not to request the vaccination exception are not fully vaccinated, were unable to receive a vaccination due to age or other reasons, or receive their vaccination out of state, may avoid travel quarantine by following the respective county's inter-county pre-test and other requirements. You need to check each respective county's rules for details. Please go to chart 3. If you lost or will not issue a vaccination card, contact the location or provider that administered your vaccine. And you can see here on the chart the different types of locations, what the process will be. We'll also be accepting the vaccine administration management system printout for those of you that registered through the VAMS, excuse me. Just log back in with your original credentials and print out the VAMS certificate. The state is also working to develop a vaccination process for travelers who receive their vaccination out of state. Once the process is identified and operationalized, the state will expand the programs to include Trans-Pacific, Continental United States, and Alaska travelers. We're targeting this summer for that. We continue to work with companies that in the future may provide the same assurance of integrity for domestic and international travel. Until then, Trans-Pacific travelers have the option of avoiding mandatory travel quarantine following the Safe Travels Hawaii pre-test program requirements. Additionally, the Hawaii Department of Health closely monitors the vaccination rates and vaccination cases around the world. The sooner we move to herd immunity, the sooner we can get to the new accepted norm. And my hope is that we sunset the Safe Travels program altogether. I know, you know, before me, the governor and lieutenant governor thanked me for all of the work that we did to move this forward, but in reality, it was the Hawaii Emergency Management Agency planners and all the other stakeholders that had a part in this, in making sure that we can move forward with this next step. Aloha and thank you.
Thank you very much, Kanahara. Moving on to our county mayors, we'll go to them virtually. First up will be Mayor Derek Kawakami, Kauai County. Hi, Mayor Kawakami.
Aloha, thank you very much for your time. I want to thank the Governor, Lieutenant Governor, General Hara, and for all of you tuning in today, thank you for your time. I think everything that needs to be said has been said. I would just like to thank our state leadership for all the work that they put in. I know a lot of people may think that this is a simple process. I've gotten to see firsthand how much detail and how much time has been spent to address the little details. And we've come to this point in time. I know a lot of our residents have been really patiently waiting for this day. We want to continue to thank people for their patience. The state can rest assured that from Kauai County's perspective, we stand by to assist as always. And we really want to encourage everybody to consider getting a vaccine, but also be mindful that we still have to keep our guard up. So that being said, we do want to thank everybody for their patience. We want to also recognize that tomorrow is Administrative Professionals Day. And the administrative professionals will be certainly answering the phone calls with a volley of questions that travelers may have. We stand by to be able to assist in any way possible. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mayor Kawakami. Going over now to Maui, Mayor Michael Victorino, Maui County. Aloha.
Aloha to everyone. My mahalo to Governor Ige, Lieutenant Governor Josh Green, Major General Hara, and all the Haima and other groups that made this all possible. As been said, and there's not much to repeat, it was a collaborative effort amongst all of us to make this a reality. Even with Maui's higher numbers than most, we are getting better at what we're doing as far as our people are concerned. And I think they feel it's time to open up a little more, especially to visit family, friends who have waited such a long time to see each other, and I mean in person. So I'm excited for what is going on right now. I am looking forward to what this will mean to all of our people, for business, family, friends, all of our people being able to move between the counties and have this ability. If they're fully immunized, they can travel without getting a pre-travel test. I encourage people to get vaccinated as soon as possible, because it not only makes it easy for travel, but you do so much for your family and friends and your community when you're fully immunized. And you know, the chances of you spreading something you really can't get, even if you get it, it's going to be a lot milder, it's a lot safer. So let's work together. So I encourage everyone on Maui County and throughout the state to please get vaccinated and get it done soon. They just will help you and everyone else. To all our visitors coming in, eventually that will happen. So I know some of them may be watching, but hang loose. We're going to get it. But in the meantime, don't forget, obey the rules, all the protocols that are in place, because if you want to come here, let's do it right. Mahalo for your time. Thank you again to all.
Mahalo, Mayor Victorino. Now moving on to Mayor Mitch Roth over at Hawaii County. Hi, Mayor.
First off, I mean, everything's pretty much been said. I'd like to also thank the governor, Lieutenant Governor, General Hara, everybody on the state team and the other county mayors for making this happen. You know, the timing is right. As you know, on Hawaii Island, we've been doing secondary testing at the airports, and we recently started checking to see who's vaccinated and letting those people who have been vaccinated be exempt from the secondary testing. As of this morning, the report that I got from Talmadge Magno, our civil defense administrator, was between 70-80% of the people coming into Hawaii County have been vaccinated already. So the timing is you know, the right time to do this. If you think about it, we're islands separated by miles of ocean, but connected by families, friends, and a sense of community. This is really the time to do this. We feel that, you know, a lot of work has gone into making sure this happened. I want to congratulate the team that put it together, and just want to thank the governor and just let him know that, you know, you have our complete support from the Big Island of Hawaii. Aloha. Thank you, everybody. And aloha. Get vaccinated.
Thank you so much, Mayor. Now moving on to our question and answer section. So participating reporters, if you have any questions, please raise your virtual hand. We'll go to Allison Schaefer's first, our advertiser. Go ahead, Allison.
So does the state have a fully functional database of all shots given in Hawaii to date, or will the vaccination exemption at first rely on travelers self-certifying? And will the state be able to verify vaccinations from other states by June, the expected target date for trans-Pacific travel? And given that, what are the true public health risks of vaccination exemptions or pre-testing fraud in Hawaii?
Thanks, Allison. I'll start and then I'll turn it over to the Lieutenant Governor. We do have a database of those who have been vaccinated in Hawaii. We've placed a priority in getting shots in arms. And so we've asked all of the various locations to input the data into the vaccination records. But clearly, we emphasized registering people and getting shots in arms as a priority. So there can be a lag in the data being entered into the state database. We do anticipate and continue to work with partners on being able to verify vaccinations that are done in other states. We currently have a pilot program with a couple of vendors who are working to get access to vaccination records in other states. And clearly, we would not be able to implement a safe travels program for those vaccinated in other states until we can get that program up and running. And with that, I'll give you over to the Lieutenant Governor.
Thank you, Gov. Very good question. So there's multiple points at which we can check and verify that our residents who have been vaccinated in Hawaii did in fact get vaccinated in Hawaii. One thing is called the VAMS system, the Vaccine Management System. And the way that rule works is all states across the country make a commitment to the federal government that if you give a shot, it's been the Pfizer and Moderna and then the J&J shot, if you give a shot, within 72 hours, you're asked to update and upload that information. Is it always perfect? No. But we are constantly pushing the edge of the envelope to make sure it's perfect so that we can have that data. It is, after all, an important piece of medical record. I know a question will come up about this. What happens if it's updated and you just can't find your darn card? You washed it in your pants. Someone tore it up. Well, we will be able to get an extra card. The governor made it very clear that that was important. So we're going to reach into our wallets and we're going to try to find it in there. Okay. I'm keeping this thing near because I can't wait to use this program, Gov. So there it is. There's my card. And let's be clear. Don't falsify this card, people, because this is a federal document, CDC, on there. And so we don't expect people to do that, but that's a big fine. That's a big penalty. But you can check. We can check with the VAMS system. We have First Vitals as a company that works with us. There's the Hawaii Health Information Exchange where data goes in. There's the Epic system that Queens and Hawaii Pacific Health use. And our community health centers are all involved with their EMRs also, electronic medical records. So there's multiple ways to do it. And that's why it is so complicated. We know our system in Hawaii, but we don't know what's going on in Wyoming. We don't know what's going on in Texas. We don't know what's going on in other states. So we are working on that with partners. But for our part, we feel we can be very solid and safe about it.
All right. Thank you very much. Max Dybul, Big Island Now. Go ahead.
Yes, this question is for the governor. I was just curious, Governor, you mentioned that you would be issuing a proclamation, and I'm sure that part of that will be to make this program official. But you also mentioned maybe an exception before May 11th. I just wasn't 100% clear on what you were saying there and if there are going to be people who are going to be able to show their vaccine cards and travel without any other hindrance before May 11th.
No, the program begins for travel on May 11th. What I was just referring to and General Howard had referred to is we do intend to make modifications to the Safe Travels program, and we would allow those who are traveling to begin entering data scheduled right now on May 7th. So the travel date, no travel for those vaccinated will be allowed prior to May 11th, which is the start date of the program. But the software will be available ahead of that so that people can log on and enter their information.
All right, thank you very much, Governor. Lynn Kalano, Hawaii News Now. Lynn?
Aloha, what about a kama'aina traveling with a child if that child is not eligible to be vaccinated? What's going to be the process for the parents with kids under 16 years old?
Lieutenant Governor taking that question.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So, again, in the spirit of the Safe Travels program, we don't want to spread any COVID. So our rules have been if your kid's under five or under, they don't have to do the pretest. But there is going to be that gap between age 5 and 16 where people, you know, 5-year-olds to 16-year-olds can't get vaccinated. They'll still, in order to avoid the quarantine, have access to the Safe Travels program and still get the test. Same rules, within 72 hours, get the swab and then travel to avoid the quarantine. I will add a couple points here. Keep in mind that it's 16 to 18-year-olds on the Pfizer vaccine. So I actually vaccinated 2 17-year-olds yesterday, 2 athletes, great kids, on the Big Island. So they will be able to partake of the program the same way. We do expect, although this is not the place for such an announcement, that at least the Pfizer vaccine is likely going to go down to age 12. Has not yet been approved for that by the CDC and the FDA, but that's probably coming soon. Until then, we're just incrementally getting ourselves to a better place so we can reunite families. This should really enhance our capacity to travel. But we're respectful of people that, number one, can't get vaccinated, like you just mentioned, the kids. And also, we're respectful and mindful that some people don't believe in being vaccinated. I'm a strong advocate for vaccination, Gov, General, everyone. But if some people choose not to be vaccinated, we want it to be fair. And thus, they would use the Safe Travels program.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. Manolo Morales, KHON2. Manolo?
Hi, this question is for General Hara. I know there have been concerns with some sort of backlog when you start with this new system. What sort of measures are in place to make sure that we don't get these bottlenecks like when we first started with Safe Travels?
Actually, Manolo, that question will really be for the counties, because they'll be doing the airport screening. My assumption would be, and you can ask the mayor since they're on here, is that they'll probably staff up initially just to see where the friction points are and then adjust as needed. I mentioned, we are having some challenges linking into the Department of Health database. So when we initially kick this off, we think the screening or the validation will be a manual process. So that will probably slow things down a little. What our intent is for the Safe Travels digital platform to electronically link into the Department of Health database and check for those fields I talked about, right? The name, date of birth, the vaccine type, and then the lot number, and the other fields that I mentioned, validate that, not even extract the data, just validate that the information is the same, and then it'll just turn you back to, yeah, you're cleared. So when the traveler goes through, they'll show the screener that they're cleared, the green check mark, and then they can go through it. It'll take probably a minute. What's also we're gonna try to build into this is, once you get accepted once, you don't have to go through the process again. The system will keep your information. So all you do on your next trip, you fill out your travel information, but then that vaccine exception will already be there.
Thank you very much, General. Mayors, did you want to add anything to Major General's comments?
I'll just say from the Big Island, with the secondary testing that we've been doing, it'll be very similar to what we've already been doing.
And from Maui, I will say that we expect some challenges, like when we first started TSA, when we first started the inter-island quarantine, we had all these different challenges. So I expect some, but I want the public to be patient, to understand we've got to work. It's a work in progress, and I'm confident we'll get it down fairly quickly. However, I expect some challenges, so I'm going to beef up the staff as best we can the first couple of weeks and see how it pans out, see how it works. And once we get back some of the major kinks, I think we'll be good to go.
All right, Mayor Kalakami, anything to add?
Our police department, National Guard, even our planning department has been stellar as far as standing up a robust screening process at the airports. It is a shared responsibility to keep our communities safe, so we're very grateful that the state has delegated some of the screening process over to the county. They are pivoting as we speak. They're doing walkthroughs and workups to prep for that date where we start screening for vaccine travelers. So we got it covered on our end. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much to our county mayors. We'll go now to Wendy Osher, Maui Now. Wendy?
Hi, this question is for Mayor Victorino, and I'm not sure if the governor wants to weigh in as well. With the rollout of the program and increased vaccinations, does it still make sense to implement a secondary test that's set to roll out on Maui in the near future?
Well, we're looking at the secondary test starting probably the first week of May, May 4th, and that's what the timetable is right now. But we are adopting the vaccination of a fully vaccinated visitor that's coming in to do what the Hawaii County is doing. And we've put that in our rules so that they will be exempt, they could go right through. So it will be just testing those who are in the Safe Travels. And if what Mayor Roth has said, 70-80%, that will reduce a whole number of people that need to have a secondary test. So we'll see how it all works out. But again, Maui has to be, has to institute a secondary test to make sure that we are statistically correct that our visitors and travelers are not the one that bringing in a large number of cases that we've had in the past.
Thank you, Mayor Victorino.
Yeah, and Wendy, I would just add that, the state is committed to work with the county and Mayor Victorino. It is about a layered approach to the health and well-being of our community, and every layer is important to reduce incoming travelers who may be infected by COVID-19, And I think most importantly, it is a balancing act, ensuring or trying to ensure that we minimize those who may be traveling who are infected, at the same time wanting to encourage our residents who are vaccinated to have the ability to travel.
Thank you very much, Governor. Going next to KITV, Annalisa Burgos.
Yes, thanks, Jody. Hi, everyone. I just wanted to get clarification from what Lieutenant Governor Green said about the VAMS certificate also. So residents, Hawaii residents who got their vaccines on the mainland, for example, would they be able to be get this exception because they would need to go on this VAMS and print out the record? Can you just explain that? Because I've gotten some people worried about this.
Sure. So we're trying to keep it really straightforward and simple at first. We know we can't be 110% perfect. The VAMS is our system that people will be able to go, and if they were vaccinated here in Hawaii and they lose their card, they can get a replacement. If an individual from our state got their vaccine on the mainland, they will not be qualified for this first iteration of the program. Eventually, as we move forward to open it up nationally, of course, then anyone that we can verify would be. Another question has come up repeatedly, and that's, how do you get these cards? I mentioned it earlier. If you happen to lose your card, we have instructed people to go back to the provider that gave them their shot. That includes Department of Health or Community Health Center or Queens or Hawaii Pacific Health. In some cases, also, people will print out their own VAM sheet. It says the same thing that your vaccination card says. And so that's another perfect way to validate that you were vaccinated here. But there will be that loophole. Some people are going to say, what about my college children that are coming back? We're mindful of that. Again, we want to be very safe and straightforward before we open it up to them. So it's really for people who got their vaccines here in our state. It's the safest way. It's the way we can validate it. And it won't be long before we can move out. But we're the first state in the country, I'm pretty certain, to do something of this magnitude. There's a small operational program in New York, but we have it being used for a lot of travelers up to, well, as you saw earlier, we've given 1 million shots and several hundred thousand people are fully vaccinated already.
Thank you very much, Lieutenant Governor. Going to Caleb Jones now, Associated Press. Caleb.
Good afternoon. This is for Governor Ige or the LG or both. A two-part question. First of all, will private vendors outside of the state or federal government have access to people's vaccination records? And if so, what safeguards are being put in place to protect those people's privacy? And the second part of the question is, how will you ensure equality in terms of people using digital platforms, as not everyone has smartphones or internet access, especially poor people? Will people always be able to use only paper cards for this program?
I'll take the second question first. Yes, if people have, the only thing they have is their vaccination record that they received when they got vaccinated, that they will be able to use that to travel inter-county. You know, certainly we would want to encourage them to enter it in the Safe Travels program, and that would allow them to travel in the future without having to take their cards. As you know, the screeners at the airport have been helping those who don't have smartphones and don't have access to the system to be able to enter that information when they're traveling. So we do anticipate that we would be able to do that. In regards to getting access to vaccination records here in the state of Hawaii, anyone that we would be working with that would access the vaccination records would have to have the approval of the Department of Health. So, you know, we continue to work with several vendors as we're implementing these programs, and the department is fully engaged with all of them to ensure that appropriate approvals are attained.
Governor, thank you very much. Going to Eleni Avendano over at Civil Beat. Eleni.
Aloha, just a quick follow-up to Caleb's question. Governor, if you could remain at the stand, just wanted to ask you, which are those vendors that you mentioned that the state is working with. And as a second question, wondering if Hawaii is the second state in the nation to adopt such a program after New York, and if any lessons have been learned from New York's passport.
Have not had an opportunity to talk with New York specifically. Mayor Cuomo was on the White House call this morning, but he did not speak about the vaccine verification program. We are working with several vendors as part of the pilot for the Safe Travels program, Common Pass and Clear, and I'm not certain who the vendors might be, but maybe General Hara or Lieutenant Governor. I don't have the vendors, and we definitely can provide that information.
LG, did you want to? LG is speaking now.
Yeah, so it's very important that we maintain people's privacy. This is a piece of medical record, although the intent in this case is actually, rather than protecting information, it's actually to share information. But there is some private information on the card. Their name is there, their birth date is there, and so we're careful about that. We will insist on HIPAA compliance. That's the health record safety compliance that is just in statute. It's mandatory. We've also, General Hara reminded me, have worked very closely with First Vitals, a very good local company. They have a lot of experience working with our healthcare system and our medical record system, so they've given us a lot of guidance. They can give us also a lot of backup support in case we have to validate anything. I think that what you're going to see, however, is partners all across the country. The governors that the Gov speaks about when they talk with the president, they are all probably being pressured by lots of people out there to do something similar to Hawaii, which means there are a lot of people in this space, like the CLEARs or the Common Pass, that want to figure out how to quickly verify and validate this person got a vaccine on a certain date, it was legit, it goes in the system, and it comes out the other side of the system with a QR code or something simple. I think that it's in the interest of the travel industry to get that done. A lot of people have other ideas about how to use this. It really has to be a way to augment people's freedoms and help them to just deal with the crisis that really kept people at home for quite a long time. I know that question will keep coming up, but it should be private, and our companies are very careful about this.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. Caleb, I see your hand up again. Do you have a follow-up?
I do, for either LG or the governor. Some places like Alaska, Vegas, the Maldives are offering vaccines to travelers as they arrive or, you know, when they're in state. Does Hawaii have any plans to do anything similar?
As of now, no. I've had this question. I'm not speaking for the Governor General on this one, although I think I know what they're thinking. We're going to focus on vaccinating all of our state first, and we think it's most important that we use all of our resources to get ourselves to herd immunity. What happens in Vegas may stay in Vegas, but what happens in Hawaii is going to be our own vaccinating program, at least well into the summer and beyond, once everyone who wants a vaccine in Hawaii gets it. Fair enough, Gov? Okay.
Thank you, LG. Allison Schaefer, Star Advertiser, go ahead. Allison, I think you need to unmute.
Can you hear me now, Jody?
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. This is for Governor or LG. Alaska already has ended its travel quarantine in February. What is the continued rationale for the travel quarantine in Hawaii from a public health perspective? And based on current conditions, when do you think ours could end?
Thanks for that question, Allison. As you may know, travel to Alaska has a very, very short season. You know, the travel season to Alaska is about 3 months, and in Hawaii it's 12 months. So they were able to drop their travel quarantine because people were not traveling to Alaska. We continue to have the Safe Travels program because we do know that the virus activity is much, much higher on the mainland, which is of concern to ours. And we have been successful in our Safe Travels program. As the Lieutenant Governor had said, we've brought more than 2.5 million travelers in the 6 months since we started this program. We have been able to do it in a safe way that has limited virus activity in our community limited the impact on the healthcare system, and most importantly, continues to have Hawaii have the lowest infection rates and the lowest fatality rates in the country.
Right. Thank you very much, Governor. Manolo Morales, KHON2, go ahead.
Hi, this is for the governor or the LG or maybe even General Hara. Is there any aim or purpose to trying to do the screening from the departure point as opposed to the arrival point? Because with safe travels, you're doing that now with the departure point. And also, just to confirm, if a Hawaii resident who get their vaccination here in Hawaii is coming back from the mainland, starting May 11th, they would still need to get tested.
Right, so Manolo, starting with the second question first again, yes, this exception only applies for Hawaii residents vaccinated in Hawaii who is traveling inter-county within the state. It does not apply to trans-Pacific travelers at this point in time. I do know that there is interest, and we definitely are working to be able to provide that for those who are traveling trans-Pacific. But we are focused on inter-county at this point in time, and will expand it as we are able to. Now, I forgot what his first question was.
Manolo, go ahead. Your first question, please.
Is there any thought to doing the screening process from the departure point rather than the arrival point?
Yeah, certainly, Manolo, and you may have noticed that there's been just a tremendous reduction in queuing at the airports because all of the airlines, well, not all of the airlines, many of the airlines have implemented a screening at the departure point for the Trans-Pacific Travel Program. As we implement the program for Trans-Pacific, we certainly would be looking to implement that. In terms of screening at the departure point here for inter-county travel, Manolo, we don't screen at the departure airport. Right now, all screening is done upon arrival. And so certainly this program would be implemented by the counties, and it would be upon arrival at the destination airport. We are hopeful that the numbers of people who are vaccinated will reduce the screening process, and we have been working very hard to minimize any delays in inter-county travel.
Right, thank you very much, Governor. Wendy Osher, Maui Now, go ahead.
Hi, this is for Lieutenant Governor. Do we have a projected date for when the state will achieve herd immunity, and how close is the island of Lanai'i to that point?
Yes, okay, so again, the question is, when will we get to herd immunity? It's not an exact science. The projections are you need to get between 75 and 80% of a population fully immunized. That looks a lot like a million people for our state, a million out of 1.4 million people. I think that we're going to begin to approach herd immunity sometime in and around July 4th weekend. That's when we'll start getting close. We won't see a magic light go off, though. I mean, we will constantly work with Department of Health to, assess and gauge how many cases we have, whether the declines in cases have corresponded to the vaccination, which is going on nonstop. That's about when we'll get there. We've done a million and, 65,000 shots. We probably have to get to about 1.8 million to 2 million shots total in order to have enough people vaccinated. A couple other important points on this. First off, right now we have done very few Johnson & Johnson shots, as you know, because of, first it didn't come live for a while. We did 17,000 total shots. That's the one and done vaccination. It's very likely that the FDA, after assessing all of the challenges with the six cases, the blood clots out of 7 million people, they very likely will revisit and very possibly allow Johnson & Johnson to be used again. That will help us get there if people choose, with some safety measures. They'll recommend safety measures. We'll talk about that in the future. So if we do the two-shot process, that would be 2 million shots to get to 1 million people, we'll likely be seeing the earlier part of herd immunity. but it won't be for everyone because adolescents will not be vaccinated, and certainly our keiki, you know, under age 16, 12, they won't be vaccinated either. That will come later. We will be safer. A lot of people will follow up and say, well, when will the gov say that we don't have to use masks? That's going to take time, because even with herd immunity, we want to keep cases way down, but that's when we get to start having those conversations more seriously, I think. So that's the way we approach it. I don't know exactly. I probably should defer to Mayor Victorino, because they've had great success on Maui vaccinating, for instance, Lanai and Molokai, and of course Maui and Kauai and Big Island, but we've all been steady, except some of the smaller islands in Maui County were able to push ahead. Is it fair for me to give that over to you, Mayor Victorino?
Yes, thank you, Governor. I just should say, Lieutenant Governor Green. For us, I think Lanai right now stands at around 65% completely immunized, and we hope in the next round, which is next week Saturday, we have another vaccination push, and we're hoping that we can get, you know, that 75 to 80% of the community immunized fully. It may take a little longer than that, but Lanai is very close. Molokai is not too far behind, and also the area called Hana on Maui Island, the east end of the island, is very close to getting herd immunity for those respective communities. Two are separate islands, and Hana is a remote community. And so that's what we're working on. And as far as vaccinations are concerned, the rest of the county is on par to get that done, like Lieutenant Governor Green said, by July 4th.
All right, thank you very much, Mayor. And we have another question from Eleni Avendano, Civil Beat. Eleni.
Aloha. Lieutenant Governor, what benchmarks need to be met for the vaccine exemption program to expand for trans-Pacific travel?
The primary benchmark is for the big guy to say, ready to go ahead, I would say. From a strategic standpoint, the important things I would say are that, number one, our first program for intercounty exception worked, that we did not see spread, that we did not see extra work for the counties and all the mayors. That's very important, because a big part of this process is to streamline travel. The next part is to know that we can at least have a good process in verifying those who have been vaccinated. It may very well be a moot point if most of the country is vaccinated and there's not widespread concern about fraud. But again, the governor has been very clear with me and General Hara that he wants to be able to verify this. That's why we're working with these companies, and there are many of them out there. We've chosen three to help guide us, but there are a lot of other cooks in this kitchen, if you will. So those are the main benchmarks. Another important point, though, that General was whispering to me before your question is, what are we seeing internationally and nationally with variants? If we were to see large outbreaks of a variant that was disconcerting or that was evading the vaccine, we probably will pause before moving too aggressively on using vaccinations as our guide to travel. So there's a lot of things at play here, but the good news is we were able to announce it today so that in just 3 short weeks we'll be starting. And then over the course of, you know, 4 to 6 weeks, we'll see if this is working well. But we will defer to the Gov, of course. I think it's been good to see a lot of safe travel going on, and I think a lot of people are going to be looking forward to using vaccination as a means to travel safely, because it's a little bit more predictable than having to get the pretest. The pretest has been, it's been good to us. We have not seen a big surge, and we have had now on many days well over 20,000 travelers safely coming to Hawaii.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. We looks like we have one more question. Allison Shavers, go ahead.
So this question is for either Governor or LG. Do you expect to offer vaccination exemptions to trans-Pacific travelers maybe in June? Would that also be phased in starting with domestic and then international travels at some other point? And when would that be a target?
Certainly, Allison, as Lieutenant Governor had said, we are working to be able to verify vaccination status for those who are vaccinated in other states. and working with companies like Common Pass and Clear, we believe is the quickest way to be able to verify vaccination status. And we are currently in pilots with both of those companies. It's been focused more on the test, pre-travel testing, but both of them are actively engaged to get access to vaccination verification. So, we do anticipate that it'll happen this summer, but it depends on how quickly they will be able to connect the networks to get access to vaccination information for all the states. The international travel is a little more complicated, but we continue to be engaged with both Common Pass and Clear are working to verify international vaccinations as well. Part of our pilot right now with Common Pass is to verify test information in Japan. And so we do anticipate that once we can validate trans-Pacific travel from the U.S. domestic, that the international piece of that would not be far behind. As you may be aware, vaccinations in Japan is lagging the U.S., and South Korea has started ramping up vaccinations, but they do, both of those countries lag the U.S. vaccinations at this point in time. We continue to monitor and engage with those countries because we do know that international travel is an important part of our hospitality industry, and we certainly would want to start travel from Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, and Pacific Island nations, New Zealand, Australia, as quickly as we can, in addition to Canada.
All right, thank you, Governor. Seeing no other virtual hands, we'll wrap up now. Reporters all good? Okay, Governor, closing.
So thank you very much for joining us. Again, just really wanted to thank all the mayors, Lieutenant Governor Green and General Hara for their commitment and all the work, the Dr. Char and her team at Department of Health for working through this exciting announcement. I do know, and I've been stopped many times, about trying to facilitate travel inter-county or inter-island. And I do think that starting May 11th will be an exciting opportunity for those who are vaccinated here in the state of Hawaii to begin traveling inter-island again. So thank you to everyone for their patience. Thank you for your sacrifice and your commitment to keeping our community healthy and safe, for being able to follow the orders and the mandates of wearing your mask, washing your hands, staying home when you're sick, avoiding gatherings, especially with people you're not familiar with. And I think most importantly, we need to continue to help each other and care about each other by doing all the things that we know reduce the spread of COVID here in the state of Hawaii. Aloha and mahalo.